My wife is Becky, she's over there, and she But no, I love coming back to Kingsville. I do, I really do. I enjoy every one of you. I enjoy all the people in the fellowship. For those of you from other churches that I don't know, this is my home. This is where I became a Christian. This is where I learned about Jesus. This is where I learned about family and relationships and just being a part of something. Something that wasn't destructive or immoral. Something that was godly, something that was eternal. And I experienced it all here, not in this exact way. Actually, I helped work to build this building. My name's somewhere on Rafter, right? But actually, somewhere over here and then over there. I think I carved it in over there too, and there's another carving over there. So I got my name carved all over this place. John called me and told me that this was going on, and my first reaction was, is there going to be food? And of course, like every great Baptist church in gathering, there is food. So I jumped at the opportunity. But like I said, I'm the husband of Becky Lee, an awesome woman that found fit to marry me. You know, she's smart, intelligent, great, but just has bad taste in men, and I won't hold that against her because I benefit out of that. But no, I'm a minister at City Union Mission, and so my nightly sermons and the times I teach class, I usually do not expect to get something thrown at me or a curse word, but looking out at this crowd, I don't think I'm going to have that in here. Unless I say something my wife would get embarrassed about. But no, I enjoy it there. The guys are really great. My heart bleeds for those men. They enrich my spirit each and every time I walk through the doors. And it's something that I love going in to do. The difficulty in there does not even come close to the rewards that I receive from those guys that I'm around. And it's just a blessing that God has saw fit to use me in that way. To use me as his servant to those men who openly reject him and openly defy him in a lot of ways, but yet at the same time are searching for some meaning, some sense of familiarity, and some sense of belonging in a world that they feel rejected by. And so for me to represent Jesus Christ in there is a both humbling and blessing opportunity for me. My story doesn't entail church or Christianity or even much family aspect to it. I grew up in a loving home. My parents were really, they sought to show me that they cared, but yet in their own way. And I'll leave it at that. They were very loving and very caring, but yet there was no structure there for me for discipline and no understanding of what it meant to be living on the right path. And so as I came into adulthood, as I came into being my own person, I lived in a destructive pattern. I would run from relationships. I lived to satisfy my own cravings. I lived in such a way as to openly defy God and all that he stood for. And that lifestyle led me led me into institutions. It led me into places that looking back on, I'm both ashamed of and it hurts to look back and see my life that way. But today I stand before you as a writer, a minister, a preacher, a husband, and a member of Kingsville Baptist Church, and all that experience. I don't look back on it and say, I wish I would have, because I don't know if this would have been in the cards for me, if God would have had this path. So I stand here in front of all you guys, this loving family, and know that because of where I came from, it doesn't really matter because I stand here today. And that's kind of the message that I hold on to and hold true to. But I lived in an open defiance of God. Running my own ways, and he was chasing me the whole while. I know that some of us, when we look back over our conversion stories and look back at our relationship with Jesus, we see God there in the struggle. even in our most wandering of ways, he was there. And eventually that led into an accident that I got into out in Colorado that started the course of me really transforming my life to be a positive member of this community. And through that, I was able to search for meaning, search for truth, and submit myself to the one true God who revealed himself in Jesus Christ and surrendered my all to him and took him as the man and the God that he said he was. And from that moment forward, and my experience of salvation was my life has been lived for Jesus. But not long after my conversion story, I had to pay some consequences for my past behavior. And that past behavior ultimately would cause the court systems to come in and arrest me. And I was arrested, but let out. And then when I was let out, I was determined. I said, you know, I'm gonna go back to this church that my mom, she had converted in 2006. And this time period was 2008. And she'd been coming here, and I remember she used to drag me, you know. I'd be so angry. I'm sure you guys got kids or grandkids or somebody that, you know, just hate going to church, or they come in late at night on Saturday, or you know, in my case, I was hungover, so I did not want to go to the church. My mom would ask me, please go to church. Please go to church. Would you please? You know, as a son who knew his mom loved him and knew that deep down she meant the best for me, knew that I was going to do that for him. The least I could do was get up early and spend a couple hours listening to this bearded preacher man talk about Jesus, even though I didn't believe about it. But the thing about it is, he always remembered my name. This guy, I could be gone for 6-7 months and come in and disheveled and straggly, and no matter what, as I walked out the door, he'd be like, "Hi, Jeff," and I'd be like, "What's your name again? How do you know me?" And he would always remember my name. And I remember whenever I got out of jail that time, I was searching for a church, and I knew that I could always go back to him because there was something about him that I could come and trust. I could trust in him. And I could trust to get my questions answered. And I really enjoyed this. But unfortunately, there was some miscommunication along the way. And I want to implore at the end of my speech to you guys about community and about community involvement and about taking care of those lost and those broken people that are in your community. It's a very tricky, tricky endeavor whenever you're talking about the souls of men, because one little thing could lead them completely away from your church, or completely use that experience as the reason why they're never going to come to Jesus Christ. It's a sad excuse, but some people will use that experience, and that's why we as Christians